Once upon a summertime, long ago but not very far away, there lived two wonderful children named Maya and Kerry, sister and brother and friends as well. It was the school holidays. And they were visiting their white-haired, sharp-witted papa. Papa lived in a big old spread-out house beside a little stream that flowed merrily to a beautiful little bay with a pretty little yellow sandy beach. In the middle of the little bay was a tiny little island on which grew the grandest and most enormous pahutukawa tree anyone has ever seen. His was the only house for miles and miles and miles and miles in every direction, and as he lived all alone except for his dog, Papa was always very pleased to see them. Well, the last day of their holiday was here, and it was the hottest yet, a salty fish and chip sort of a day, with the sun as bright as a baby's smile in a cloudless sky, and the children were looking for one last adventure.
Papa, have you ever been out to that tiny little island in the middle of the bay?
Well, golly, Maya, not for many, many years. I used to row out there in my little jolly boat and watch the dolphins swim by. The boat's down by the stream if you want to have a look. And there's life jackets in the shed. What do you think, Kitty?
Sounds like a real picker-upper. See you for supper, Papa.
And so the two youngsters laughed and squealed as they covered themselves with sunscreen and hats and ran down to the stream to where the old yellow jolly boat lay on the grass.
Here are the oars. Here are the jackets. Let's push off and explore that island.
One, two, three. Oh! Shh!
Sitting side by side with an oar each, their life jackets snugly fitted and a happy tune upon their whistling lips, Kerry and Maya rowed down the stream and out to the deep, clear blue water of the bay. The seagulls talked to each other in witches' wails as the little boat made its way across the bay. As they rowed closer and closer, they began to realise just how hugely big the pahutukawa tree that grew on the island really was. And as they pulled the boat up onto the pebbly beach, they both nearly fell down in surprise.
Ooh,
ha-ha.
Wow,
rub my ears and honey and tie me to an anvil.
Blow me down.
Crikey.
Crikey.
For there amongst the thick spreading branches was built a magical treehouse with a huge driftwood ladder winding up the enormous tree like a vine to a massive front door with large brass hinges and a ship's bell shaped like a clam. The treehouse was a crazy collection of rambling rooms, reached by ramps and rope bridges, ladders and layers linking perching platforms, and everywhere round porthole windows sparkling in the sun. Birds' nests snuggled in the thatched roofs, and high up in the bending branches, fantastic flags flew in the fluttering breeze. Truly an amazing sight, truly.
It looks like somebody's took a wrong turn and drove a boat into a tree.
What an amazing place. Someone must live here. Lucky them.
Well, just as Maya put her hand on the ladder, the children heard a troubled call from the other side of the tiny island.
Weep, weep, weep.
What on good green earth is that? It sounds like a bat in a blender.
Sounds like we should help. Let's go.
Clambering over the giant pahutukawa roots that looked so much like the crooked fingers of their papa, slipping and sliding around the seaweed, the two adventurers rounded the corner and were astounded to see a beautiful blue dolphin lying in the shallow water and a tall woman in a red coat, knee-deep in the surf, trying with all her might to push the squealing animal back into the clear, deep water. The dolphin looked so worried and helpless, and the tall woman looked so worried and helpless as well, until she caught sight of the two stunned children.
Well, boil my cabbages, if it isn't two heroes, and here's me in my hour of need. I don't know how you got here, fell out of the sky for all I know, but my name's Captain Pippi, and for golly goodness sake, could you please get over here and give me a hand?
The children's open mouths snapped shut, and they ran over to where the stranded dolphin lay and splashed into the waves.
She's too heavy to drag, youngsters. We'll dig ourselves a trench back to the deep water. Keep her wet, but don't get any water in her blowhole. That's her big ol' nostril.
Well, both the children had got salt water up their noses before and thought it no fun at all. So even in the scary excitement of digging and splashing and digging and splashing and then digging some more, they kept the blowhole dry. Even so, the dolphin was starting to grow weaker and weaker.
The tide's going out. Are we going to make it?
Well, that's harder to pick than a broken nose, dearie. We need more help, methinks.
And saying these words, she walked out into the water, giraffe-sized strides taking her out past the breakers and up to her tummy. She cupped her hands together and blew hard between her thumbs, and out came a sound like a steamship's whistle.
What is she doing? What about the dolphin? Is she as mad as a moo-moo?
Just at that second, an incredible sight made Kerry and Maya fall down in surprise. A giant orca, that's a killer whale, children, like a big black bus with a huge fin as tall as a house, was coming straight for the little beach.
Look out, Captain Pippi!
But Captain Pippi obviously wasn't afraid of 5 tons of muscle and teeth and jumped up and down and waved her arms over her head like a helicopter. The orca seemed to nod and then suddenly disappeared under the water as the amazing woman came splashing back up towards the beach.
Quickly, children, up that rope into the tree. We're about to have a bit of water delivered.
Both children dashed up the rope like slippery eels, with Captain Pippi close behind, leaving the poor stranded dolphin on the beach feeling very alone and thinking that all humans were indeed mad as moo-moos. No sooner had they climbed up into the branches when the orca came right in close to shore, leapt up into the sky, did a somersault with a half twist and belly flopped into the shallow water.
Boom! Oh, yikes!
A wide, wet wall of wild white water roared up the beach, covering the dolphin and everything else. The wave crashed against the huge tree with a shudder that was felt to the highest branches, and then sucked itself back out to sea with a noise like a giant drinking the last bit of a gravel milkshake through an enormous straw. All the seaweed and driftwood and half of the sand was sucked away, and on the empty beach, the dolphin was not to be seen.
Oh dear, oh gosh, oh no, will she be all right? She might have been knocked out and drowned.
Or eaten by that orca.
Captain Pippi squinted her brown eyes with a worried look as she swatched the swirling foamy waves.
Let's not fret yet, pet. Dolphins can hold their breath for minutes and minutes, and anyway, orcas like squid and fishes best for tea. Look, there she is.
Far out in the deep blue harbour, the rescued dolphin could be seen leaping about, doing acrobatic tricks and splashing happily back into the water. With a final flick of her tail and a spray of water, she was back out to sea to join her family. What a relief.
Well, 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 3 holes in the ground full of water. After a mission like that, my new friends, it must be time for lunch.
The children agreed with rumbling stomachs. And as they followed the sure-footed Captain Pippi along the branches, up and down ladders, across a rope bridge, and past a spiralling slide that curled right down the centre of the tree, amazing, they calmed down enough to get a good look at Captain Pippi for the first time. Captain Pippi could be described thus. Hair, black and glossy, held back by a headband of shells. Face, kind and sort of wrinkly. Eyes, milk chocolate brown. Teeth, white. Nose, yes. Hands, 2. Coat, red like a fire engine. Boots, black and shiny with pointy ends bent around in a spiral. Trousers, yellow with about 25 pockets that bulged like a belly with the promise of magical things. Well, listeners, they soon found themselves seated around a big wooden ship's table in the largest room in the treehouse, and with 2 loud claps of her hands, Captain Pippi summoned her lunch helpers. And what helpers they were! At the sound of her claps came scampering and scurrying and strutting and swinging a score of tiny monkeys. Capuchin monkeys with white faces and cheeky eyes open wide with curiosity at the new guests. The children laughed in wonder as the clever creatures laid out cups and cutlery around big white plates and clapped and cheered as they brought plates and dishes of delicious smelling food, furry fingers flying with steaming sauces and gravies. What a meal! As they ate, Captain Pippi told them her astounding story, how she'd been the captain of a circus ship, a floating animal town with elephants and tigers and monkeys on the trapeze and tiny horses and dogs that could ride bicycles. They toured the world doing circus shows and became so famous they had performed for kings and queens and presidents and prime ministers. All was well until they encountered a massive storm with waves like huge watery fists that picked up the boat and smashed it into tiny bits. Thankfully, all the animals could swim and they all ended up on this tiny island. But it was enough for Captain Pippi to realise that the open ocean was no place for wild animals. They belonged in the jungles and grasslands of their home countries. So together they built this incredible treehouse using broken bits of long forgotten ships that washed up on the beach. One by one, Captain Pippi had sent the animals back to their homes on passing boats, and so now only the Capuchins remained, there not being many vessels on their way to the Amazon rainforests around these parts.
And when they're gone, I shall be all alone. I need another human people person to talk to, I think, or I shall go quite mad as a moo-moo. After some dinner music, I think.
From behind her chair, Captain Pippi pulled a mandolin, which looks like a small guitar with 8 strings and a body shaped like a pear.
Well, Captain Pippi, my name it be, and I have been sailing since I was 3. There's only one place I'd like to be, surrounded all sides by sea. And the ship, she likes to rock and roll, and golly, it's good for your soul. Great steamship to driftwood raft, I scurried about from fore to aft. The storms did come, but I just laughed. I never felt sick, so I never barfed. And the ship, she likes to rock and roll, and golly, it's good for your soul. So come on, join me if you've the notion to feel the motion of the ocean. Such a lovely locomotion. Don't forget your suntan lotion. And the ship, she likes to rock and roll, and golly, it's good for your soul. Golly green gobstoppers, what is going on?
The Capuchins had been doing the dozens of dirty dishes, but came crashing and clattering and clambering, and clutching an ancient telescope and pointing out the window. Captain Pippi jumped up at once and peered through her old spyglass out the porthole towards the open ocean.
Shiver me sheep! She's a ship shooting by! But where they're headed, I wonder? There's a flag. Let me see. A green flag with a yellow diamond and a blue circle with tiny stars and a white stripe. Good grief, guys! Which country is that?
Both Kerry and Maya had paid attention at school and so could both shout the answer out at once.
Brazil!
And then there was a raging ruckus. As everybody realised at once that most of the Amazon rainforest is in Brazil and here was a ship going right there and it was gosh darn getting away.
Quick, to the jolly boat everyone! Last one there's a wooden leg!
And so faster than a flock of flying fish, the children, Captain Pippi, and the tumbling troop of monkeys leapt onto the spiral slide in the centre of the treehouse and slid speedily down and around. Whee! And down and around and down some more until they landed on the soft sand of the beach in a big pile of kids, captains and Capuchins.
Oh, wow! Oh.
Captain Pippi pulled an inflatable life jacket from one of her 25 pockets and before he could say, do what you order and be safe round the water, the little yellow jolly boat with its strange crew was rowing out towards the speeding ship. Maya and Kerry rowed like they had never rowed before, with Captain Pippi standing in the bow, waving her arms at the ship and shouting,
stop! Stop!
While the little monkeys clambered all over her and tried to hide in her pockets.
I don't think we'll make it. They haven't seen us.
What shall we do, Captain Pippi?
Wait just one hot minute, my little chili peppers. I've got it.
And from one of her packed pants pockets, she drew out a beautiful hand mirror. And standing as still as she could in the rocking rowboat, shone the bright sunshine off the mirror towards the streaking silver steamship. Flash, flash, pa-flash, flash, flash, pa-flash. And what do you know? The Brazilian boat suddenly hooted its horn. Slowed down and gradually turned towards the tiny boat.
They've seen us! Hooray! here.
Very flashy, Captain Pippi.
In a matter of moments, the jolly boat was alongside the great big ship, the sailors stopping their ship deck soccer to look over the side and point and laugh at the little yellow jolly boat and its unusual collection of passengers. A few words of Portuguese with the smiling sailors was enough for Captain Pippi to convince them to take some extra passengers, and with a fond farewell, her furry friends fairly flew up the rope ladder and onto the ship and sailed back to their homeland.
Well, that's that, and I guess I'm going back to doing my own dishes.
By the time they returned to the island, the sun was very low in the sky, and Maya and Kerry knew they had to get back before Papa began to worry. They all agreed it had been a most splendid adventure and promised to come and visit next holidays, and gave each other big hugs and handshakes and high fives, and then the two youngsters paddled back across the sunset to Papa's house. They ran up the beach and found him in his hammock and told him of their amazing adventures as fast as their tongues could talk, both speaking at once and interrupting each other with details and descriptions, and when they had finished, Papa laughed and told them how proud he was of them.
I'm so proud of you two.
They had homemade fish and chips and went to bed tired but happy. They really didn't want to go home, but as they got on the bus the next morning to head back, they waved to the tiny little island in the middle of the bay, and from the top of the tree came the flash, flash, flash of a mirror in the morning sun, Captain Pippi saying goodbye. A month later, they received a letter from Papa saying he had gone out the next day and bought an outboard motor for the jolly boat and visited Captain Pippi on the island, and now they were great friends. They had started an animal rescue hospital in the treehouse and were taking care of injured and stranded creatures before releasing them back into the wild, and neither of them were lonely one bit. So everyone in this story, from the dolphin and the orca and the capuchins, to Papa and Pippi, and especially the two wonderful children, brother and sister and friends as well, lived happily ever after. Snip, snap, Snover, that story is over.